Thank you. Good morning, everybody. We have a few announcements today to make, starting with what happened this week is Pastor Dennis is away in Alberta for a well-deserved holiday and visiting his family. And so Pastor Lynn had everything ready to go, and then she contracted COVID on Thursday. So she's feeling really quite well. She said it's just like a bad cold, and she said Lynn is her husband's taking good care of her. She's just staying in her room, and to this point, no one else in the family has it, and she's feeling well. So because of that, we are very privileged this morning to have Pastor Darlene Harrison with us. We won't make her stand up twice, but you'll see her when she comes up. Darlene has been in the pastorate for 20 years or more, and was out in Melville, and then has been here in Regina, I think she said, to retire, right? Came to Regina to retire, and she's been kept busy ever since. I've known Pastor Darlene through a few different ways, but she's a member at New Hope and does supply preaching. So Pastor Darlene, welcome to Christ Lutheran. We're happy to have you. Okay, so I get the joy of doing the announcements. So I'm going to start with Wednesday is our Super Supper and the Ash Wednesday service. No, it's not Super Supper. It's Pancake Supper. So Tuesday is Pancake Supper. Thank you. Would you like to do the announcements? Okay, all right. Okay, sorry. Tuesday. And so we'd really like to have a good turnout. It is for the youth group. They're raising money to go to their big gathering later this summer. And I think this is our first Shrove Tuesday in probably in 3 years. So it's going to be exciting. So it starts at 5:30, goes 5:30 to 7, and the prices are in there in the bulletin. $20 a family or individual prices. So please come out and do that if you can support our young people. Then the next day is our first Super Supper. Someone asked me where the sign-up list is, and I don't know. Do you know that, Irene? We don't know where there's a sign-up list. But if you can bring soup on community board. Okay, community board back. Thanks, Joan. Okay, and then the Ash Wednesday service to follow, which is always a really meaningful time. Let's see, I'm going to skip some of these. Then the Lenten service starts after that. Super Suppers. Pastor Lynn was going to be starting Christian Caregiving, A Way of Life this coming Wednesday, but just to be on the safe side, she's backed it up a week. So I think that's March 8th, Wednesday, March 8th. Will start the Christian Caregiving Way of Life. We've been involved for, golly, more than a year, maybe 2 years, I can't remember, with bringing food to Trinity Lutheran every Thursday. Christ Lutheran is responsible for that. And we have regular people that are bringing the sandwiches, but we need help now with setting it up. Okay, her name's escaped me. That just moved. Yes, she used to really organize it and get it there and hand out the food, and now she has moved to Saskatoon. So if that interests you at all, we could really use someone to come. It's a 2 to 3 hour commitment on a Thursday morning, but so you have to go to Trinity, get all the bags filled, and yes, Mrs. Roth. Oh, and it's fun. Because Mrs. Roth is there. So, yeah, no, it looks like a good time. So if that interests you, please think about that, and you can phone the office for more information. And because we have Pastor Darlene, I'll give this one an extra plug too. New Hope is every year, I don't know if you guys have been, but every year they do a mystery dinner, and it's really fun. It's usually a farce of one kind or another and a delicious dinner. So that is coming up. March 15th, so you might want to consider that. And finally, our birthdays. We have two special birthdays. Rose Huber is celebrating, Pastor Lynn doesn't usually say the number, but years of life. Is Rose here this morning? No, but the next one is, and I'm going to say loud and proud, Dr. Henry Kinzel, 95 years old today. God bless you, Pastor Kinzel. Okay, I think that's it. So we'll just take a few minutes now to prepare for worship. Yes? Oh, and Irene wants you to know the tax receipts are in your mailers, if you can please pick those up. Okay, and anything else? Okay, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Time to give. sorry I didn't have my mic on to begin with, so this will be better now. We'll have our call to worship. Beyond our busyness, above the cold winter floor, there is a glory rising, born of heaven, and reaching out to each one of us.
Light that shines through the clouds, an invitation seeking all who we are, that transfigures the world.
That transforms darkness into hope, that brings life from a cross where old life ends and new life is born.
In glory, Jesus meets us here, raising us from depths of valley to the height of the mountain, carrying the weight of our humanity to the heights of heaven's glory.
Let us worship from the mountain and hear again, "This is my Son, my chosen. Listen to him." So during the season of Epiphany, we begin with a thanksgiving for baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation.
Amen.
People of God, in the baptismal waters we travel with Christ from death to life, our past, our failure, our doubt, and our shame are drowned and gone here.
Wash us clean.
Our fear, our confusion, our self-righteousness, our despair, all is washed away by grace.
You, O God, wash us clean.
Our pride, our hypocrisy, and other people's opinions of us no longer have the power to define us.
You, O God, give us new life.
The Spirit lives and moves through us now, a great and joyful mystery, so we may bring love and mercy into the world as the body of Christ.
You, O God, give us new life.
Rejoice that God has claimed us in this baptismal grace, not by our own doing or believing, but by God's mercy alone.
You, O God, give us new life.
And so as we begin worship, we give thanks to God for the gracious gift of baptism that joins us together in Christ by the Spirit's power. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. We praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
And now we join in our song of praise, "The Lord of Light." In this hour, we come to you as we are, in our strength and in our weakness. Bless our world in all its beauty and its pain. with your Spirit's redeeming power. As you transfigured Jesus on a mountaintop, transform us as we worship you today. Touch us with the presence of your Spirit, that we may shine Christ's light into a world longing for peace. Amen. We're seated to hear the readings.
In the first reading from the books of Exodus, we hear that Mount Moses and Mount Sinai experienced the presence of God for 40 days and 40 nights. The glory of the Lord settled on the mountain, and on the seventh day, God called out to Moses. On the mountain, God gave Moses the stone tablets inscribed with the Ten Commandments. A reading from Exodus, the 24th chapter. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there. I'll give you the stone tablets with the instructions and the commandments that I've written in order to teach them." So Moses and his assistant Joshua got up, and Moses went up God's mountain. Moses had said to the elders, "Wait for us here until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur will be here with you. Whoever has a legal dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. God's glorious presence settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from the cloud. To the Israelites, the Lord's glorious presence looked like a blazing fire on top of the mountain. Moses entered the cloud and went up the mountain. Moses stayed on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. Here ends the reading. In the readings from 2 Peter, we hear about God's voice heard at the Transfiguration, declaring Jesus to be the beloved Son. By the activity of the Holy Spirit, God's voice continues to be heard through the word of Scripture. A reading from 2 Peter, the first chapter. We didn't repeat crafty myths when we told you about the powerful coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Quite the contrary. We witnessed our Savior's majesty with our own eyes. For Jesus received honor and glory from God the Father when a voice came to him from the magnificent glory saying, "This is my dearly beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice from heaven while we were with Jesus on the holy mountain. In addition, we have a most reliable prophetic word, and you would do well to pay attention to it, just as you would to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning stars rises in your hearts. Most important, you must know that no prophecy of Scripture represents the prophet's own understanding of things, because no prophecy ever came by human will. Instead, people led by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. Here ends the reading.
For the gospel acclamation, open the eyes of my heart.
Of my heart, I want to see you.
the 17th chapter. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John his brother and brought them to the top of a very high mountain. Jesus was transformed in front of them. Jesus' face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with Jesus. Peter reacted to all of this by saying to Jesus, "Lord, it's good that we're here. If you want, I'll make three shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While Peter was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. A voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased." Hearing this, the disciples fell on their faces, filled with awe. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said, "don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Don't tell anyone about the vision until the human one is raised from the dead." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and at this time I invite the Sunday school children to follow Carrie and head upstairs. Oh, there is no Sunday school. Who knew? Oh. I'm sorry about that. Oh. So grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, it's so good to be with you. And we certainly send our prayers to Lynn for a speedy recovery from COVID, and prayers for Pastor Dennis and Beth for a wonderful few days away and a safe journey home. So as you already know, on this Sunday morning, we're going to commemorate the transfiguration of our Lord. Doesn't that sound impressive? Well, every year we hear the story at the beginning of our Lenten journey. And I wonder how many times some of you have already heard this story. But this morning we have Matthew's version. And Luke and Mark also have the story in their Gospels, so we know that we're always going to begin our Lenten journey with this story. So perhaps we need to unpack the word transfiguration. And if you go Googling it, the word transfiguration, you'll find out, of course, that it simply means a transformation or a change in appearance. So obviously, something happens to Jesus, and he becomes changed in appearance. This is a story about one of the scariest and most amazing things that ever happened to Jesus' three best friends. In Matthew's gospel, just prior to this story, Jesus has fed 4,000 besides women and children. Following that, Peter has declared that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus tells his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And he has told his disciples that they must deny themselves and take up the cross and follow him. Well, I'm sure the disciples are feeling confused and probably very frightened. I wonder if Jesus knows that Peter and James and John need to take a break. So Jesus takes them for a walk in the countryside and up a hill to get some peace and quiet. Jesus has been telling them that following in his footsteps would not make life easy, and that sometimes it is really tough to keep on doing good and loving people. So when they get to the top of the hill, suddenly a very strange thing happens. Peter and James and John can hardly believe what they are seeing as Jesus' face and clothing begins to shine so brightly. It's as if the light is shining out of them and out of him. So imagine, just imagine what the three disciples must be thinking. Then two other people show up, two old friends of God, Moses and Elijah, who lived a long, long time ago. And they have a chat with Jesus for a while. I'm sure that Peter and James and John are wondering what on earth is going on. So I want you to imagine that you are Peter, and I want you to imagine yourself saying, "Show yourself, God. Let me see you." Oh, the years that I've longed for just one moment when I would know, when I would know what you look like, God. Maybe we all have that longing. Maybe we all secretly want to be that special person who will have that extraordinary divine experience, that encounter. Imagine if it really happened to you. Imagine actually seeing God. A moment of seeing beyond, being in the full wonder of God's presence. No more doubting. You would know for sure because you've seen it with your own eyes. God, for real. What if it really happened to you? You would be changed, and you would know. From that moment on, everything would be different. If only I could see God. If only you would give me that one clear, unmistakable, perfect moment. Show yourself, God. And then it happens. So imagine again that you're Peter who says, "Well, here's how it happened. I was watching Jesus. I know what I saw. The light in his face, in his clothes, in all of him. It was pure light. And then those two figures appeared out of nowhere. Two men standing there talking to him. The three of them all in this pure light, just standing there talking. I knew who they were. I knew that it was my moment, my glimpse of God, and I wanted to hold it, to keep it, to have it again. Well, I said maybe we should make some dwelling places, some shrines perhaps. We need to do something special. Let's get at it." But there was no time to take it in, to treasure it, before we were overshadowed by a bright cloud. Then, as deep as the terror, a voice as pure as that light, and I know what I heard. "This is my son, the beloved. I am well pleased. Listen to him." Then it was over. We were alone again, the scrubby hillside, the cool air, the four of us, no one saying a word. Has it changed me? I don't know. What feels different? I don't know. Will there be no more doubt in my mind? In that moment, what did I think I would be sure of? Oh God, I really don't know. Well, those who followed Jesus, especially the disciples, thought they knew what they were in for. They did not follow him for nothing. They were going to witness the establishment of the kingdom of God right here on earth, no more and no less. Every blind man who saw, every deaf woman who heard, every mute child who talked was for those disciples another sign of things to come. It was as clear as that. But of course, they really did not know what they were in for. They had no idea of the changeover that would take place in the life of Jesus. They had no idea, no idea at all, how he who healed the blind will be blinded by the crown of thorns, how he who healed the deaf will be deafened by the blows on his head, how he who healed the mute will be silenced, hanging on the cross, paralyzed by nails to his hands and his feet. They had no idea that their expectations would be drowned in the water and the blood streaming from the cross. So I wonder if that's the reason why Jesus brought the disciples to the mountaintop. Is that why he's transfigured in front of them? They're on a mountaintop high above the valley of ordinary things, in a solitary place away from people, in a silent sight where God's voice can be heard without the distraction of others. A mountain always speaks of stability, permanence, and strength. And that is where the transfiguration happens. It's an experience that literally blows one's mind. And so many questions go unanswered. How can the holy presence of God come in a human form? How can the exciting brightness of the physical Jesus be explained? How can Moses and Elijah appear in bodily form? Does God really come in a cloud? Does God have a real voice? Perhaps we cannot answer these questions, and perhaps we don't need to. Maybe like Peter, we do not know what to say. Like the disciples, we too are overcome with awe and adoration. Like the disciples, we may have to admit that we cannot really comprehend how the transfiguration happened. The element of the miraculous remains. We do not have the answers, but we've had the experience. And we want to remain right here where we're feeling good. Have you ever had the sense, as you sit in this worship space, that you've had a sense of wonder? You've sung hymns and you've prayed, and you're in this place where you could just stay and feel good. Any of you ever had that? But of course, that is not what God is calling us to do. We need to try to understand why the transfiguration happened. Jesus knows how offended his disciples will be when they see him being taken captive, crucified, and killed. Jesus realizes that there is nothing physical about him as a human which in any way identifies him as the Son of God. There's really nothing much to attract the disciples to him and keep them attached to him throughout his suffering and death. So, lest the disciples become totally disillusioned and desert him altogether, perhaps Jesus permits them to peek into the company of heaven, that they might know him as the beloved Son of God. In essence, the transfiguration is a kind of secret peep show before the cross, the resurrection, and the ascension, where we get a glimpse of the inner nature of the true Son of God. The transfiguration brings hope to the disciples. For while hope is not needed by the disciples as long as Jesus is with them, hope will be needed by the disciples as they see on that fateful Friday night Jesus hanging on a cross. And we, as followers of Jesus, we need hope as well. We need hope as badly as the disciples of Jesus did. We need hope when we see humanity itself in agony, crucified by the oppression of 2/3 of the world's people against the other 1/3. We need hope when we see world governments spending almost all of their human resources on war and nuclear weapons. We need hope when we see the exploitation of the poor, when we see hunger and starvation all over the world. We need hope when we see that our world is not free of prejudice and hatred. We need hope when our lives are turned upside down by disaster, death, and suffering. But Jesus wants us to know that there is hope. Isn't this the reason that Jesus allows us to see what the final outcome will be, which is Jesus as the sign of God's living presence among us? Out of the clouds comes the voice that says, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." It is by seeing Jesus as he comes to us in history and hearing his words that we can, in some small way, see and hear God. This account of the Transfiguration is placed before us as we stand on the threshold of Lent, so that we might, through seeing and hearing, behold the glory of God. And it is this seeing and hearing that gives us both courage and hope. It is the hope that Jesus gives to each of us. It is the hope we can struggle in this world and in ourselves. It is hope that sends us forth from this place, sends us out to do what we possibly can do to make this world a better place in which to live. It is hope that sends us out to share the good news of the glory of Jesus Christ. So soon our Lenten journey will begin. We are compelled to go out, to leave this safe place, to go out preaching to all who will listen about the good news of our grace-filled God. Our response is to go out and do what we can to bring hope. It can be nothing else. In response to Jesus Christ, the Beloved, the Chosen One, the one God asks us to listen to. So may your Lenten journey be a blessed one. Amen. Our hymn of the day is "Lord, the Light of Your Love," and I'll ask you to stand.
Happen.
Join me in the affirmation of faith. As followers of Jesus Christ living in this world, which seek to control, but which others view with despair, we declare with joy and trust, our world belongs to God, from the beginning through all the crises of time, until God's kingdom fully comes. God keeps covenant forever. Our world belongs to God. Let the earth be glad. The Spirit is at work, renewing creation. Praise the Lord. We rejoice in the goodness of God, renounce the works of darkness, and dedicate ourselves to holy living and loving. As covenant partners, called to faithful obedience and set free for joyful praise, we offer our hearts and lives to do God's work in God's world. And we are confident that the light which shines in the present darkness will fill the earth. Come, Lord Jesus, our world belongs to you.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. The prayers will end with "Let us walk," and our prayerful response will be "In the light of the Lord."
Heavenly Father, working through human events to show your presence and strength, work through each of us as we seek to respond to your call to serve. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. Almighty God, shine in our lives like you do in the universe, maintaining life, order, balance, and forever making new creations. Mend us as needed, bend us as necessary, that we may be your new creation in body, mind, and spirit. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. Holy Spirit, put your seal upon us that we may be filled with enthusiasm for God's work through us as agents of reconciliation. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, when we do not know what to do, when we are overwhelmed, give us the wisdom to listen, to marvel, and to renew our commitment to follow you all the days of our lives. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. Transfigure your world as you transfigure your church, Lord God, that all may be made new and whole. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. We pray for all who have needs beyond our power to meet, knowing that you alone are the great physician. We pray for those in hospital, those who are sick and shut in, and those who are in need of care. Let us walk
in the light of the Lord. Light of the world, shine upon us. Amen. Amen.
And now in the words that Jesus taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated for a few moments. And our offering will be brought forward at this time. Thank you. And we give thanks to God for God's abundant blessings in our lives.
Source of light and love, all things belong to you. You generously share us with the blessings of home, food, friends, and life itself. Receive this portion of what you have given us. May our gifts and joyful service strengthen your church, that we may share good news and compassion with those in need. Amen.
We stand again to sing our sending song, Do Something Beautiful.
I also want to say thanks for having us again. And if anyone is ever interested in playing music, we get together maybe once a week sometimes. If you're interested, just come and talk to any of us and we'll get contact information so that we can let you know when we get together.
Coming week, may you experience the presence of God with joy. May the holy cloud comfort you. May the divine voice encourage you. May the power of the Spirit transform you, transform us, transform our world. Amen.
Go in peace, inspired by Christ, to love and serve.
Thanks be to God.
To all. Still.